It's such a pleasure to be back in Montreal. I feel I have friends and colleagues here with whom I share values. And we are, I think, trying to do the same thing, to improve health, reduce the unfair distribution of health in the population. We're on the same side. And this French thing's really easy. I was listening. Gradient social, Whitehall, groundbreaking, leadership, Harvard. It's really easy, this French thing. No difficulty at all. Coming to Canada, one hears bad stories. Amid the bad stories, one hears good stories. But the bad story relates to, of course, health among First Nation Canadians. But there are good stories, even there. In fact, when I wrote this book, what moved me most was not yet one more story of human suffering, but what moves me is triumphing over adversity, that amid human suffering, we see things getting better. So let me start, I had to borrow a copy of the book. Let me start with chapter 8. Anyone can start with chapter 1. In May 2011, Mary hanged herself. She was found in the yard of her grandparents' house on a First Nations reserve in the province of British Columbia. She was 14. She was a First Nations Aboriginal Canadian. Her story has particulars. All suicides do. She'd been physically and emotionally abused at home and in her community, and possibly sexually abused. Her mother was mentally unstable and heard voices. Officials attributed the suicide to a dysfunctional child welfare system, and to the fact that no one took her complaints of abuse seriously or acted on them. There is another way to look at Mary's sadly foreshortened life. And that is to realize that though her personal tragedy was unique, there are many young Aboriginal Canadians who experience similar tragedies. In fact, as I'm sure you know well, the youth suicide rate in British Columbia is 5 times the average for all young Canadians. One cannot understand fully why Mary saw no way out without also asking why so many other young Aboriginal people in British Columbia reached the same desperate point. Lalonde and Chandler, the two researchers, thank you. Lalonde and Chandler, the two researchers who studied this problem, had as a starting point poverty, what they called bone-grinding poverty. But, as they said, there were 200 bands of First Nation people in British Columbia. And in the first 6 years of study, 90% of the suicides occurred in 12% of the bands. And over a longer period, and you probably know these data, what they found was a distribution according to what I call community empowerment. They classified communities according to the degree of self-government, participation in land claims, and community control of health services, education, cultural facilities, and police and fire services. And the more of these that were present, the lower the youth suicide rate. Chillingly, in the disempowered communities, young people kill themselves. So when I began, I said, I hear these terrible stories, and you're all familiar with them. But it's not a council of despair. community action. Empowerment, it takes government action. Community action does not let government off the hook, but social action can make a difference. Mary could not solve her own problems. Of course not. She was depressed because of what was happening to her. But social action could solve the problems for people like Mary. I was giving a talk about the health gap in the US, and I'd written about the American city of Baltimore. And a few months before I was giving my talk, Baltimore erupted. The precipitant of the civil unrest was the killing of a black man in police custody, or should I say, one more killing of a black man by the police. That was the precipitant. But the underlying cause was inequality. Because in fact, in Baltimore, it was not the whole of the city that erupted, it was one part. And I'd written about this in Upton Druid, which is where the civil unrest happened. Life expectancy for men was 63. In Roland Park, it was 83, a 20-year gap. I was told by important official sources, a reporter for the Metro, that yesterday that the gap in Montreal was 11 years. And I'm sure it must be correct if a reporter for the Metro told me, but it was confirmed by somebody more authoritative this morning. It's 20 years in Baltimore. In London, when we had the riots in the summer of 2011, they broke out in Tottenham. I had been citing Tottenham as having the worst male life expectancy in London, 17 years shorter than an area in Kensington and Chelsea. If you know London, Kensington and Chelsea is the ritzy part, Harrods, it's where all the people whose money is squirreled away in Panama, when they come to shop, they go and shop in Kensington and Chelsea. Well, what a surprise that the riots didn't break out there. They broke out in Tottenham. Now, I don't think that civil unrest causes ill health, and I don't think that ill health causes civil unrest, at least not immediately. But I think deprivation, lack of engagement in the benefits that society has to give, causes civil unrest and causes ill health. And I talk about the lives of people in these two different areas of Baltimore. I was at a meeting at Johns Hopkins, which, as you know, is in Baltimore, and a couple of young doctors kidnapped me, said, "You cannot sit here in this meeting hall. We have to show you Baltimore." So they took me to Upton Druid. Upton Druid, there are some streets where every second house has a diagonal red cross on the door. They're condemned as unfit for human habitation. If there's an emergency, the police and fire services will not go there. Can you imagine what it's like living in a street where every second house is condemned as unfit, and if there's a fire, the fire service won't come? Good heavens. I was visited a shanty town in Kolkata in India. Slightly more sophisticated housing in Baltimore, but it must have some of the same feeling. And LaShawn, a typical resident, if his household was at the median income of that area, $17,000 in 2010. The kids did badly at reading in school. They missed a lot of school. 90% did not go on to college. And then look at this. Each year, a third, aged 10 to 17, arrested for juvenile disorder. I asked a colleague who's an expert on drug policy, does that arrest by the age of 17 count as, is that on the criminal record? And he was slightly unsure. But if you're applying for a job and you're asked, have you ever been arrested? Well, if it's a third each year, you can imagine it must be at least two thirds by the age of 17. And you apply for a job and you're asked, have you ever been arrested? You either lie, which is not very good when you're applying for a job, or you tell the truth and you don't get the job. Either way, you don't get the job. And my friend pointed out that a survey he'd done in Washington, D.C., one third of men in Washington, D.C., 18 to 24, one third had been arrested for drug dealing. I heard the chap who was responsible for The Wire being interviewed. The Wire, which I've never seen, but it's a bit like confessing that you've never read Macbeth or you don't know who Hamlet is. So I've never seen The Wire, but I have seen Hamlet and I have read Macbeth. I was Macduff in the school play, but I heard The Wire man being interviewed, and he pointed out that the police in Baltimore, because of the war on drugs, are rewarded for the number of young men that they arrest. Their incentives. Ooh, you're black, you must be dealing in drugs. And again, in New York, I mean, the war on drugs is the worst social experiment anybody ever conceived. In New York, it's legal to possess marijuana. And there were 50,000 arrests for possession of marijuana. How is that possible? It's legal to possess it. It's not legal to display it in public. So the police say to a young black man, empty your pockets. You're arrested. They riot. But they have poor health. And in 2005 to 2009, 100 non-fatal shootings for every 10,000 residents and nearly 40 homicides, fatal shootings. So remember these figures, not for very long, but just for one slide. And these young doctors who took me around, we went to Roland Park, which is where the Johns Hopkins professors live, with leafy gardens, green lawns, no condemned houses, 93% two-parent families, median household income, not $17,000, but $90,000. They do well in reading at school. 75% completed college. In Upton Druid, they don't go on to college, but 75% completed college. Juvenile arrests, one in 50. Not one third each year, one in 50. No non-fatal shootings. And four homicides as compared with 40. So these are dramatic differences. It relates to differences in health. It relates to differences in civil unrest. And of course, it relates to differences in the opportunity to lead a flourishing life, which I think is crucial to health. But, and it's true for Canada too, ill health is not confined to the socially excluded. The problem of inequalities in health in Canada is not confined to poor health for Aboriginal Canadians and good health for everybody else, but there are social gradients. These are the US figures by years of education, less than 12 years, 12 years, 13 to 15, and 16 plus, white women, black women, white men, black men. It's a gradient. And there's been a lot of debate about this particular graph. Anne Case and Angus Deaton, of course, it got a lot of coverage because Angus Deaton won the Nobel Prize for Economics in 2015 and then published this paper. As I was at a meeting in Washington at NIH on Tuesday, one of the reasons it got published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, it was rejected by the New England Journal and JAMA, but anyway, got a lot of press coverage. This is mortality ages 45 to 54. France, Germany, UK, Canada, Australia, Sweden. Canada looks pretty good. There's a lot of difference. It must stick in the craw of France that Canada looks so much better than France does, but never mind. That's US Hispanics, and that's US non-Hispanic whites. Oh my goodness. Now, the debate has been about whether it's really an increase or just a failure to decline. But the fact is, it's much worse for US whites than it is for these comparator countries. And what are they dying of, these people aged 45 to 54? Number one, poisonings due to alcohol and drugs, which includes opioids. Number two, suicide. Three, chronic liver disease related to alcohol. And then external causes of death, other violent deaths. I call this disempowerment. Angus Deaton said, it's an epidemic of despair. I've been interested in Glasgow, and I talk about Glasgow in the book, and I think I'll talk about Glasgow in a moment. The excess causes of death, if you compare Glasgow with Liverpool and Manchester, all deprived cities, post-industrial decline, but Glasgow has higher mortality. And the excess is particularly for suicides, poisonings, alcohol-related causes, and external causes of death. The same as the excess in US non-Hispanic whites. What this means is that we cannot console ourselves that somehow this is a problem for the socially excluded. It's not for everybody else. Now, the fewer years of education, the steeper the rise, so the gradient is getting steeper. And this is the gradient. This is an updated version of figure one from the health gap. Looking at life expectancy in England, for local authorities, neighbourhoods, classified by income deprivation. So here we have the least deprived, and the top graph is life expectancy. And you can see this remarkable gradient. People near the top have shorter life expectancy than those at the top. In the middle, shorter than those near the top, all the way from top to bottom. And the bottom graph is disability-free life expectancy. And it's steeper. The gap here is about 11 years. In other words, people at the top, longer lives, are living about 11 years of those lives with disability. And here, it's 20 years. Shorter lives, but leading more of it with disability. It's a gradient. So when people ask me, why should I care? I'm an average person. And if poor people have poor health, well, so what? And as I've said to people, you just imagine you're of a particular set of political beliefs, and you think that poor people are the architects of their own misfortune, that they're irresponsible, the language that's used in Britain, they're skivers. I think actually people who are not paying tax in offshore in Panama are bigger skivers than the poor who are on benefits. But poor people are morally inferior. And if they have poor health, they only have themselves to blame. So that's one view. A different view would be, I do care about poor people and poor health. For people in this room, that's probably why you do what you do, why you get up in the morning. But for the average person who's a different political view from the first one, they may say, yeah, I do care about poor people. But in my heart of hearts, I say, thank goodness that's not me. That doesn't affect me. The gradient affects you and me. And you and me, all of us, we're all affected. In fact, with taking the disability-free life expectancy figures, a gap of 17 years between the 5th centile and the 95th centile, I argue that people in the middle, on average, have 8 fewer years of healthy life than those at the top. 8 fewer years of healthy life means earlier onset of decline in grip strength, earlier onset of difficulty walking, earlier onset of cognitive decline, and shorter life. So it affects people in the middle. Canadian data, but there are lots of other, this is mental health showing the gradient, but and that the gradient's actually getting bigger for mental health. But there are lots of other data from Canada that show it's not just the socially excluded and everybody else. The lower you are, the worse the health. So the average is affected. Suppose you're a 15-year-old boy. Go into a typical American school and count 100 boys just like you. 13 of you will fail to reach your 60th birthday. Is 13 a lot? It's double the Swedish figure. It's higher than in the UK. It's higher than in virtually every European country. Goes without saying that it's higher in Canada, higher than in Canada. In fact, in the US, it's higher than in 49 other countries. There are 194 member states of the World Health Organization. The US ranks 50th out of 194. And spends 17.5% of its gross domestic product on health care. At this think tank in Washington on Tuesday, it was rather predictable. Some people said, oh, it's lack of access to health care is the American disadvantage. And rather predictably, I said, no, it's not. This is not a health care issue. Poisonings, suicide, alcoholic liver disease are not due to lack of access to healthcare. They're due to disempowerment. They're due to psychosocial distress. And we see gradients everywhere. This is under 5 mortality by wealth quintile. If you thought the problem was the bottom quintile, if you're in the second bottom quintile in India, I think it's reasonable to ask, why do my kids not have the same chance of survival as the top quintile? In fact, I think instead of focusing on the bottom, we should focus on the top. And by that I mean not to call around and ask those people at the top how they're managing their money these days, commiserate, but what we want is everybody to have the good health of people at the top. That means focusing on the gradient. And if you're in the top quintile in India, you might ask, why are we not doing quite as well as the top quintile in Bangladesh? Or why are we not doing as well as the bottom quintile in Peru? In other words, we need to improve the whole of society, not focus only on the worst off. So we see these gradients everywhere. This is a version of the Preston curve. I got the data from Gapminder. Income per person for a country, so adjusted for purchasing power. And what you see is at low levels of income, a small increase in income is associated with a big increase in life expectancy. If you're a country with very little income, having a bit of money makes a difference. My Indian colleagues say, when India started to get annual growth rates of 7 or 8% in gross domestic product, it could do things that it could never do before. There are still a lot of people in India, more than half, living below $2 a day. But when your economy is growing at 7 or 8% a year, you have opportunities. A bit of money makes a difference. And it's true for households. If I'll talk before I finish about food insecurity, but if you haven't got enough money to feed your children, a bit of money will make a difference. There is a myth, and it is a myth, that's what the evidence shows, that if you give poor households in Canada or the US or the UK a bit of money, they'll waste it. You know, it'll go on beer and cigarettes. That is a myth. That is incorrect. It's factually wrong. And people who say that are talking from prejudice, not from knowledge. Very clear. If households can't afford to feed their children, they get a bit of money, you know what they spend it on? Feeding the children. But there are countries that fall below the line. I was in Uzbekistan recently. There's Kazakhstan. Uzbekistan looks very similar. So it's got the same national income as Costa Rica and Chile, but a huge difference in life expectancy. So relatively poor countries like Costa Rica, Chile, Cuba can get remarkably good health. And at that same level of income, Russia, Belarus, the Ukraine, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, the former Soviet Union countries have remarkably poor health for the same level of national income. So at low levels of income, some money makes a difference for countries, as it does for households. But once you get up to about $10,000 of purchasing power parities per person per year, and you go all the way up from Costa Rica and Cuba to Luxembourg with its ill-gotten gains, there's no relation between national income and life expectancy. For a country, getting richer is not the secret to getting healthier. And in a way, that's probably true of households in rich countries too. Yes, there is a correlation between income and health, and it goes right through the gradient, but it's probably not the money per se that's doing it. So, what is doing it? Well, we need to take a life course approach. Chapter 4 of The Health Gap, Early Child Development. Chapter 5 is on education. Chapter 6 is on employment and working conditions. Chapter 7 on older age. Chapter 8 is on communities. I read out from that. Chapter 9 is about whole societies. Chapter 10 is the global perspective. And chapter 11 is me saying, come on guys, let's do this. So give every child the best start in life. I mentioned Glasgow a moment ago. When we published the report of the Commission on Social Determinants of Health, and I probably talked about this last time I was in Montreal, I won't embarrass Richard by asking him if he remembers. I pointed to the fact that in the poorest part of Glasgow, Calton, life expectancy for men was 54. And in the richest part, 82, in Lenzie, a few kilometres away. 28-year gap. I tried to update the figures when I was writing the book, and the administrative boundaries have changed, but it looks like it's still a 20-year gap. And I was at a meeting in Brussels, and somebody came up to me with a nice Scottish accent and said, "I'm from Lindsay, and I drink in the pub with a friend from Calton." And my first thought was, it doesn't surprise me that you're from Lindsay. I'm sure people from Calton don't attend European meetings in Brussels. But he said, "I drink in the pub with a friend from Calton." And the other night we were talking, and it turned out my friend had made no arrangements for a pension, for superannuation. And I asked him, "Why not?" And he said, "Because I'm 54. Oh dear. And I said, "I'm delighted that my research is being discussed in Scottish pubs and elsewhere, I hope. But it wasn't supposed to be a statement of destiny." It's like the chap who on his 100th birthday was asked how he felt. And he said, "If I'd known that I was going to live this long, I would have looked after myself." So we didn't want the life expectancy of 54 to be a statement of destiny. This story I'm about to tell you about Jimmy was brought to me by a detective chief superintendent in charge of homicide. This man, as he said, he never thought he'd mouth the words. He was in charge of homicide in Strathclyde, where Glasgow is. He was asked, would he like another 100 police officers on the beat? And he said, "No, I'd prefer 100 health visitors who would visit families with young children. That would be more important to preventing homicide." So he told me about Jimmy. Well, it was, his name's not Jimmy. And Jimmy, single mother, who had a succession of male partners, each of whom abused Jimmy physically, psychologically, if not sexually. They moved house every year or year and a half. He had behavior problems by the time he entered school. As soon as he was old enough, he was labeled a juvenile delinquent. He was known to the police. He was involved in gangs. He never had a proper job. Any money he gets goes into drink and drugs. His diet, if you could call it that, is pub food, fast food, alcohol, a series of short-term girlfriends. But there was a question of alcohol-fueled violent behavior to these girlfriends, and each of them tossed him out. And his life expectancy is less than the Indian average, 8 years shorter than the Indian average. Let's come back to your attitudes to the poor. Do you think Jimmy was the architect of his own misfortune? No matter how much of an ideological libertarian you are, you can't ignore the evidence that Jimmy's tragic situation is a result of his tragic life history. And if you're a do-gooding public health person and you say, "You know, Jimmy, you should eat a proper diet and don't smoke. And if you're feeling under stress, go and talk to your friends about it and it'll get better." I wish I could do a Glaswegian accent and say what Jimmy's likely to say to you, but the second word, the second word would be off. And you can guess. If you want Jimmy to take responsibility for his own life, give him a stable early childhood, give him access to quality education, give him opportunities, and if he then chooses to be a scallywag, that's up to him. And we can't say that we caused Jimmy's problems. But here, we can say, we caused Jimmy's problems. The society that we think is a good society was leading to the Jimmys of the world with life expectancy 54, compared to the average for men in India of 62. And parenthetically, Jimmy is fantastically rich compared to the Indian average, as is LaShawn in Baltimore, $17,000. wow, that's 3 times the Indian average of purchasing power parities. So it's not just money, it's what money enables you to do in a given context. And looking at the Jimmies of the world more generally, here we're looking at cognitive development at children from 22 months of age to 10 years of age from the 1970 British birth cohort. Look at children who at 22 months were in the 10th centile of cognitive development. If they grew up in families of low socioeconomic status, they remain low. There's some regression to the mean. If they grow up in families of high socioeconomic status, they catch up. Now look at children who at 22 months were in the 90th centile. If they grow up in families of high socioeconomic status, they remain high. Grow up in families of low socioeconomic status, they decline. Let me be really crude about this. If you're dumb and poor, you stay dumb. If you're dumb and rich, just hang in there. It'll all come good. If you're smart and poor, that's not enough. You've got to be smart and rich, and then you stay intelligent. If all the differences at 22 months were biologically determined, genes, nutrition and the like, and all the differences associated with the socioeconomic status of rearing were social, the social trumps the... Oh God, did I say trump? cancel that. We'll scrap that. The social outweighs the biological. But of course, not all the differences at 22 months are biological. The quality of early rearing and nurturing makes a big difference. And we've been monitoring early child development. It's based on a similar approach to the one that Clyde Hertzman had pioneered in Canada, and other colleagues here in Montreal as well have been doing. So it's looking at the children who have a good level of development at age 5 by local authority, ranked by an index of multiple deprivation. So you can see that the best off local authorities have a higher proportion of children age 5 ranked as having good level of development, and the worst off local authorities a lower proportion. But they scatter around the line. And again, this is almost a litmus test for your politics. If you're to the left, you think the problem is poverty. If you're to the right, you think the problem is poor parenting. And I think you're both correct. That the circumstances in which parents are trying to parent affect what they can do. If you're told you must read to your children every night when you put them to bed, but you haven't got a bed in which to put your children, it's a bit harder to read to them when you put them to bed. If you're working on shift work and you're a single mother and you're told on Tuesday that Wednesday you're on the night shift, and you think, what am I going to do about the children? I can't just, there's nothing to do. So you say, I can't go on night tomorrow night because I've got to be home with my children. They say, you're fired. Now you can't pay the rent. And some do-gooder like me is saying, you know, you should really read to your children. Cuddle them a lot. So the circumstances in which you're trying to raise your children impacts on what you can do. And if we look at reading scores at age 7 and math scores in the UK, I don't like to use the term risk factors, but these influences all make a difference. So the more of them you have, the lower the reading scores and the lower the math scores. Low birth weight, not being breastfed, maternal depression, lone parent, medium family income, parental unemployment, low maternal qualifications, damp housing, social housing, and area deprivation. The more of those you have, the worse your children's reading scores and math scores. This is not being a bad parent. This is living in adverse circumstances. Can we make a difference? And I was asked this by the Metro reporter yesterday, and I said, yeah, there are two kinds of ways to make a difference. One is this way. Reduce poverty. This is child poverty before and after taxes and transfers. So in Latvia, and child poverty is defined as less than 60% median income. In Latvia, before taxes and transfers, child poverty was 35%. In Sweden, it was 32%. After taxes and transfers, child poverty in Latvia had gone down to 25%. In Sweden, it had gone down to 12%. Sweden, they've decided they don't like child poverty. In Norway, they like it even less. So they use the tax and benefit system to reduce child poverty. I wrote a piece for Scientific American recently, and in it, I used the example of the United States and Australia. I thought if I use Sweden, you know, for Americans, Sweden is sort of a Marxist-Leninist hellhole, you know. So, but I thought Australia sounds a bit like Texas. And the figures I had were less than 50% median income for poverty. These are less than 60%. Before taxes and transfers, child poverty in the US, less than 50% median income, is around 22-23%. And after taxes and transfers, it's still 22%, hasn't changed. In Australia, it's gone from 23% to 11%. And the editor, Scientific American, said, I think we should take that out of the article. I said, why? He said, I got a feeling you're talking about redistribution, and that's not on the agenda in the US, so it's irrelevant. So I think we should take it out. I said, I think we should leave it in, precisely because it's not on the agenda. You want to improve early child development, then you should leave it in. So he was a bit begrudging. He said, okay, but I don't understand what a social transfers. I said, they're benefits paid. He said, I still don't understand. What are benefits paid? And then he came back to me, we're doing all this by email. And then he came back to me, he said, let me see if I understand what you're saying. You're saying in Australia, that's my example, richer people pay taxes, and those taxes are used to support the income of poorer people. I said, yeah, absolutely. He said, some countries really do that? That's why I thought it was quite important to leave it in. So one way you can deal with poor quality early child development is reduce poverty, reduce child poverty. And it's possible. Not to reduce child poverty when you're a rich country is a political decision. It's not one of economic necessity. That is a political decision. And I'm not the least bit political, but that's a political decision. The other way is to invest in early child development. For example, preschool. I think I may have got this initially from Clyde Hertzman, but it's the kind of thing that he did. Look at Cuba, Costa Rica, and Chile. the solid line is the percent of preschool enrollment children aged 3 to 5. So in Cuba, 100% of children are enrolled in preschool. In Costa Rica and Chile, it's very high. In Paraguay, Dominican Republic and Colombia, the very low proportions enrolled in preschool. Now the dotted line is reading scores in the sixth grade. The higher the proportion of young people enrolled in preschool, the better the reading scores. And it turns out the longest life expectancy is in Cuba, Costa Rica, and Chile. And the shortest is in Paraguay, Dominican Republic, and Colombia. It's not proof, but it's consistent with saying good early child development, better performance in school, better living conditions in adulthood, longer life expectancy. And the problem is that income inequality of this generation impacts on the next generation. This ghastly thing called intergenerational earnings elasticity is the similarity between the income of adults, of parents, and the income of their adult children. So if the income of adult children exactly resembled the income of their parents, in other words, no social mobility, rich parents have rich children, poor parents have poor children, middle parents have middle children, a country would score 1. So the US and the UK are very high. If there's no relation between the income of parents and the income of children, Finland, Norway, Denmark, Sweden a bit worse, then a country would score 0, much more social mobility. Canada is more up at this end. The problem is that that's correlated with the Gini coefficient of income inequality. The higher the Gini, the higher the income inequality, the less social mobility. We've got a lot of pious claptrap spoken in Britain about encouraging social mobility. But the problem is we've been encouraging income inequality at the same time. Well, they're pulling in opposite directions. In other words, the greater the gap between the rungs of the ladder, the greater the distance, the more difficult it is for the next generation to get from one rung to the next. Education. All over the world, what we see, women with no education, their children have a higher probability of dying in the first year of life. Women with secondary or higher education, much lower. In all of these countries, they're really, I don't think, exceptions. Another way of looking at this is the difference between countries is much less for women with secondary or higher education than it is for women with less education. You want to reduce infant mortality? Educate women. Probably the biggest single contributor to the decline in infant mortality globally has been education of women. Won't the world be full of babies if you educate women and their babies don't die? Well, no, actually. Bangladesh, total fertility rate by education. Secondary or higher, 2.5. India, 2.1. Ethiopia, 2. If women are educated, their babies have a higher probability of dying and they have fewer babies. They have choices. They can control their reproduction. They can control other things too. The percent of women who say it's acceptable for a husband to beat his wife if she refused to have sex with him. What? Mali, 73.5%. But the more education, the less likely a woman to endorse that proposition. So education good for women's own health. I showed you the US figures earlier, and men too. Good for women's offspring, good for control of their reproduction, and good for their control of their bodies and sexuality. Good for human rights. And I'll just move on. Fair employment and good work for all. I have a lot to say in the health gap about fair employment, but I have a lot to say for people having the opportunity to have coffee and nutrition in this room, so I won't talk about it all this morning. But what I will say, and a conversation I had in Toronto the night before last suggests that the figures in Canada are exactly the same, is one of the things we want occupation to do, work to do, is to relieve poverty. These are UK figures. Poverty being below the minimum income threshold, by whether you're in a workless household or a household where at least one adult is working. More than half the families below the minimum income threshold are in households where at least one adult is working. And in those households where at least one adult is working, three quarters of the adults were working. These families are in poverty not because they're feckless, not because they're of low moral worth, not because they're skiving, but because they're lowly paid. And that relates to ensuring a healthy standard of living. One of the problems is that income inequality is increasing, that's Canada, in all of these countries. There's Mexico, it was very high and it's getting bigger. Belgium, the Netherlands and France have been fairly stable. Greece and Turkey, I'm sure Greece is not an economy most of us would like to emulate, so that's probably not the best example. But in most OECD countries, income inequalities are getting bigger. This is, I'm showing you this because I want to have a rant. This is only tangential to my main point. In Britain, we have our politicians lecture at us that we are the envy of the rich countries. Our economy is doing better than any other rich country. So vote for us. This is what the figures show. Average real wage index for developed G20 countries, where 2007 is 100. There's Australia, 109, Canada, 105, Germany, France, US. UK's got to be here somewhere. Oh, there we are. We're the best of any OECD country. Real wage index is 7% below where it was in 2007. Vote for us, because unless you vote for us. Now, I'm trying to emphasize that I'm not party political. I am, though, for public deliberation. A democracy depends on informed population. And if the population is being systematically misinformed, how can we have a proper deliberative democracy? I don't have an answer, that's why it's a rant. In Canada, everything's perfect. Well, not everything. This is household food insecurity prevalence rate. And there was a compelling presentation at the meeting we were at in Ottawa on Sunday about food insecurity in Canada. By income quintile, so 2007-2008, 4 years later, food insecurity had gone up. And this is the gradient. So it's not, you'd think the food insecurity would only be in the bottom 20%, but it's not. This is the second bottom quintile, 12%, something like that, food insecure in the second bottom. So it's a gradient. And the person in Ottawa who was making this presentation said, most people in food insecurity in Canada look like me. And what she meant was, she's white, not Aboriginal, not Indigenous. I went up to her afterwards. I think she had a body mass index of about 19. And I said, my guess is most people in food insecurity do not look like you because they have a higher body mass index because they can't afford nutritious food. They're having lots of calories because that's cheaper per calorie. And growing old healthily. Life expectancy at 50. This relates to the issue that all countries have social and economic inequalities. If health follows the social gradient, then are health inequalities inevitable? ISCED is the International Social Classification of Education. 0 to 2 is primary, 5 to 6 is tertiary. Life expectancy at 25. The inequalities are always bigger for men than for women. There's 15 European countries. Sweden has the longest life expectancy at 50 of these European countries and the narrowest gap. At the other end, Hungary, Estonia, Bulgaria, Romania, Poland, and what you can see are bigger gaps, lower average and bigger gaps. And just as I described in comparing infant mortality by education, the differences among countries are much less for people with university education than they are for people with primary education. So we all know that health is a matter of choice. So if you're going to choose to have low education, you'd be really stupid to choose to be born in Hungary or Estonia. A much more sensible choice would be to be born in Sweden or Italy or Norway. Or if you're silly enough to choose Hungarian parents, at least make sure you get a university education. And woe betide you if you had adverse child experiences that make it harder. Then that was stupid. You should have chosen to have parents who did not abuse you and neglect you. Am I being ironic? the global element. I think this is actually quite a good, well worked out example. Indian farmers live on the edge. Every half an hour, an Indian farmer commits suicide. India is so vast that any number sounds enormous. Every half an hour, you know, somebody commits suicide. Probably every 10 minutes somebody swears. I don't know. But is that a lot? Well, it is actually a lot. It's 3 times the rate for all India. US cotton farmers received $3 billion in subsidies in 2008-09. Removing US subsidies would allow the world price of cotton to rise by between 6 and 14%. Indian cotton farmers are living on the edge financially all the time. And the price of their cotton is being undercut by US cotton subsidies. Now the US is doing that for very good domestic reasons, but it's having a global effect of leading Indian cotton farmers to commit suicide. I skipped over ill health prevention. I wanted to call my book The Organization of Misery. I'd been quoting Pablo Neruda because we launched the WHO commission in Santiago de Chile. So when we launched it, I quoted Pablo Neruda and said, rise up with me against the organization of misery. But the publisher said, you can't call a book The Organization of Misery. Nobody would read it. I said, what about The Organization of Hope? Well, better, but a bit obtuse. So I compromised. I called it The Health Gap, a bit boring. But the first chapter is called The Organization of Misery, and I document the systematic inequalities in health within and between countries. And the last chapter I call The Organization of Hope. What I said earlier was, come on guys, let's do it, because there's good evidence. I describe myself as an evidence-based optimist. The evidence leads to my optimism. Look at the differences between countries. Peru, Brazil, where are we? Colombia, Cuba, and the US. In the 1950s, the gap in male life expectancy at birth, 43 to 66, was a 23-year gap among these countries. Wow. Here we are. Something like 68 to 76. An 8-year gap. Dramatically smaller. And in fact, Cuba, as I'm sure you know, now has longer life expectancy for men than the United States. So we can close the gap. I think we should give aid to the US to relieve its miserable situation. And it probably Britain's to blame because it colonized North America, 200, 400, whenever it was. So, but anyway, I'll leave that aside. And within countries, here's the social gradient in stunting in the first year of life, low growth in the first year of life in Brazil, 1974 to 75, by family income quintiles. And is 74, 75 a steep social gradient? 1989, 1996, look at 2006, 7. Hey guys, we really can do this. We really can make a difference, really quickly. I get asked, is the evidence important? I think the evidence is crucial. We need to have the political will to implement the evidence, but the evidence shows that we can make a difference really quickly. That's got nothing to do with my talk. And in a way, that's why I wrote the book. I said in Ottawa on Sunday that when we began the Commission on Social Determinants of Health, we said we wanted to create a social movement. And my brief experiences in Canada this week suggest to me that the social movement is alive and flourishing in Canada. Thank you.
Hi, Kate Frolic from the University of Montreal. Thank you so much for your always inspiring talks. Lots of food for thought. So I have a thought that I'd like to share, and I know that it goes outside of the confines of what we normally do, and you touch, of course, a lot on it. But I'd like to hear your thoughts on moving more in that direction, how we do that. So we all work in public health, and many of the people in the room are epidemiologists. We're interested in health. Health is the outcome in unequal health. And you start off in health. Your first chapter is on inequalities in health. And eventually we get to the determinants. We get to the inequities and the determinants. What if we spun it the other way around and started off with the inequities and the determinants? So you started off with First Nations people in Canada, and it seems to be that one of the issues that has helped us in the last year, aside from changing government, which was major, was realizing that openly in the press, that there are a large number of First Nations communities in Canada that don't even have running water, that have housing that is so poor that the windows are broken, and you've surely spent time in the winter here, you know that is inhumane. If you list all of the things that those communities do not have, and then list all of the things that all the people in this room do have, it is glaring. And you don't even have to talk about health. All you have to do is talk about the determinants themselves. So that's the one piece. So starting flipping on the head and talking about the inequities in the determinants. Then, so how do we work up? So we're not specialists in that, most of us. We work with specialists in that, but how can we dig deeper in order for us to have impact? And I think that the commission really helped us move in that direction, but there's more work to be done. So that's the first thing. The second thing, and this is going to be really uncomfortable for people in the room, and is for me, is to turn things on our head, on its head, and talk about the privilege that we have, and what that does to this inequality gap. And I'll take a glaring example in Quebec. We have a publicly funded education system, but most people opt out if they have the money, and they put their children in private schools. And those schools then have the best education. And if you are driven around to Montreal North or other poor communities in Montreal, you can be sure there are no private schools there. So these are the issues that we don't like to talk about, because we want to send our children to the best schools. And we want to have make sure that they have the best. So how do we deal with that? Because at the end of the day, that's equally important.
Well, on the first, I'm sure you weren't clapping the start of my answer. On the first, there's no conflict here. We need to work with other agencies and other specialists. I don't know whether health in all policies is the right way to think about it, but what is certainly the right way is to engage education, to engage the Ministry of Finance, to engage the environment, to engage housing. Now, my approach to this, and when people don't have windows and don't have water, maybe you don't need the health argument, but my approach to this is the reason you need to take it seriously is because of the impact on health. It's not just because broken windows look unattractive, it's because it damages people's health. But as a health person, people working in organized public health, we don't necessarily have control over those levers, but we need then to work with people who do.
Can I just add one other thing? There was one thing that was important.
I'm not sure I can keep all this in my head. Okay. I'm still trying to remember the second one.
Can I come back to
that? Well, you have to ask the chair. So we need to work with others. On the second, what about our privilege? Yeah, it's difficult. I write about education in Finland in my book, and I was invited to Finland by the Finnish Medical Association, my esteemed role as president of, I was going to give a lecture, and they said, would you like to see some hospitals? Oh, God. I said, no, I'd like to go to a Finnish school. So one of the doctors, he said he hadn't seen a Finnish school since he'd been in school. So we went, and somebody from the Finnish Teachers Union accompanied us, and we met the head teacher of this school. And what they said to us was the number one principle, because Finland always does best in PISA scores of all European countries, which is why I wanted to pray at the shrine of Finnish education and find out what they were doing. The number one principle is equity. They do not have private education. I think the idea came from Canada. Make healthy choices the easy choices, I think the Ottawa Charter or whatever it was. So if there's huge public investment into comprehensive public education and teachers are paid well and highly valued, then whatever temptation you might have had to send your children to a private school in Finland, you don't have that temptation because it's not there. Because there's huge public investment in the quality of public education. I don't blame people for sending their children to private schools if it's available. I don't blame them for doing that. No, you make those choices, and I'm not in the business of saying people are morally good or bad. But if you put huge investment into public education, then we all send our kids to the public system, because that's what's in town.
Thank you. Richard, and then you is. We've been working with evidence and trying to push evidence, and that's the basic issue, and that's the first thing we say to all the people that we work with, give us evidence, we need that. But when we work with the decision makers, very often it's difficult to push evidence. Not that they don't listen to it, but they have so many other factors.
Yeah.
So you have been in touch with so many decision makers around the world. So how can you push the evidence and the other factors? How do you use that? I know that you're a specialist in having been able to drive policies, but you've been blocked in some certain countries where they don't want to look at it.
Yeah.
How would you manage that? And when we are facing those kind of issues where we have information, but very, very large difficulties to push the policy that go forward.
Well, I can only tell you what I do. I haven't done a proper analysis, and I'm sure people, political scientists, tell me there is an evidence base that helps you understand when policies are taken up, when proposals are taken up into policies and when they're not. I think two characteristics are important. One, recognizing an open door, so you can push on an open door. And the second, having some patience. So I'm impatient and patient at the same time. I mean, let me give you an example. I went to Mexico in 2007. I met the Secretary of Health, the Health Minister, and senior people under him, the top civil servants. And as I did when I came to Quebec, I suggested that they set up a Mexican review on social determinants and health equity in 2007. 7 years later, 2014, I was invited back to Mexico, and I'm in the Ministry of Health, and I looked around and I thought, this is the same room I was in 7 years ago. And now we're having this discussion. So I said that to them, and there were very senior officials and deans of medical schools and Academy of Medical Science. They had the whole movers and shakers. And I said, I was in this room 7 years ago, making the case of how Mexico needed to take a concerted approach. I'm a patient man. 7 years is not such a long time. If I could get you to start working on it now. And the top civil servant came to me afterwards. He said, I hope you won't need to come back in another 7 years. And I wrote to the person who'd organized this meeting and said, what's happening? He said, oh, there's a great deal happening. We're really doing a lot. It's really getting off the ground. So the politics has got to be right. And that's not my expertise. I mean, how all the back room making decisions in smoked salmon filled rooms is not my expertise. Well, they're not allowed to smoke anymore, so it's got to be smoked salmon instead of smoking. Saumon fumé. is that? Thank you. So I know what I do, which is present the best evidence. And let me tell you, indulge one more, and I tell this anecdote in the book, that I was introduced to the chief executive of one of the big global management consultancies. And I went to see him, and I was hoping that to get some help pro bono. And he said to me, tell me, when you go into a country, do you have money you can offer that country? Me? No, I have no money. He said, do you have a cadre of trained people that you can send in? I said, no. He said, what do you have to offer a country? I said, the opportunity to create better health and well-being for the population. And he said, you really do need help. Well, I think we are offering something. We're offering the opportunity. And I say to politicians, And I really am naive, but I say to politicians, why did you go into politics? And I know that, you know, I know all those stories, but why did you go into politics? Surely it's because you wanted to improve things for the population. And we're giving you the evidence of how you could do that. Well, the evidence is there's a lot of people listening. I said Canada, of course, but in Brazil and Chile and Costa Rica and in Slovenia, not just in the Nordic countries, a lot of people are listening.
Thank you very much, Sir Michael, for an inspiring talk, and I'm happy to see the end of the story. It's a very good end. There are several to-be researchers in this room, and we encourage them to come and see you. And as a researcher, because you've had a tremendous research career, we have a bit of the impression that we know it all, that the only thing needs to be done now is action. So what would be the three most important research questions for which we need urgent research at this point that you could leave as a legacy to the 20 or 30 some researchers to be in this field?
Well, I wouldn't answer it as three. I would say if you look at the health gap, I got the best evidence I could find to underpin my arguments. But I would also say, although I think of it as a call to arms, it's also a research agenda. The evidence is not as good as it should be on any of those. So chapter three was on early child development. The evidence is nowhere near as good as we would like it to be. I presented it as if we know exactly what to do. You either reduce poverty or you have good services to improve early child development. There's a huge research agenda there on what sort of services, how are they working, how do you do it? So when a single mother is juggling between paying the rent and feeding her children, how are we going to provide the services to improve early child development? Huge research agenda. Education, the social gradient in educational performance. Talking in Britain, and I'm sure it would be no difference in Canada, every politician who comes into it says, I want to improve education for everybody. That's what they all say. And it hasn't worked. It really hasn't worked. Big question of how do you do that? And that means working beyond our comfort zone. That means working with people that we don't normally work with. But huge research questions. Employment and working conditions. I cite examples from one of the big issues, which I didn't talk about this morning, is the proportion of young people not in employment, education or training, NEET as we call it in Britain. So school leavers who go onto the scrap heap rather than go into something that will set their careers off on a good path. Well, there's a couple of good examples from Wales of identifying young people in school that they think are at risk of becoming NEET and working with them. Well, that's a huge research agenda. And what they found in those two communities in Wales where they did it was that youth violence went down. So not only did they get kids into education or training, but youth violence. If we look at employment and working conditions, so I'm giving you more than three, I think there's a whole research agenda here. Is the future of work that people like us will have interesting, fulfilling work, we get up in the morning knowing that what we're trying to do is make a difference, improve people's lives. It's wonderful and it's interesting and fun and frustrating and all that stuff, but it's terrific. On the other hand, are you work fodder in insecure, badly paid, poor quality jobs? How are we going to solve that? I mean, it's a huge agenda and what it means for health. Older people. how do we get people socially engaged? In Toronto, there were one of the people I met in the brief time I was there, comes from an organization called Voices from the Street. And they're working to get people with mental illness into the workplace. How do we do that? You know, it makes a huge difference to their prognosis, as well as older people who are able to work. So, and then at the community level, community engagement and empowerment, at national policy level, and at the global level. So I would say what I've done is I've laid out a call to arms, but at the same time, it's a research agenda. In none of those areas do we have the knowledge that we'd like. And we need to do them both at the same time.
We have students here, we have people in training, and some of them want to ask questions. I have two.
Je vais utiliser vos talents de traducteur parce que je veux pas que le sens soit changé tant que ça va être en anglais. Dans le fond, j'ai une double question. On a entendu parler beaucoup des pays scandinaves qui sont des modèles en termes de, d'égalité sociale. J'aimerais ça savoir c'est quel le modèle selon monsieur qui serait à suivre, puis c'est quoi les clés de succès de ce modèle-là, puis ça serait dans quelle région, quel pays. Puis la deuxième, c'est s'il y aurait des exemples concrets où les politiciens sont venus le voir pour poser des questions, pour avoir des conseils, pour réduire les inégalités sociales. C'est arrivé, ça m'intéresse beaucoup.
C'est bon. The first question is relative to the Scandinavian countries as models for the rest of the developed world. Which one of these countries provides the best example or leadership role model?
What's interesting about the Nordic countries is that, and I spend a lot of time there, is that none of them feels they're doing enough or doing it well enough. I mean, I went to the Swedish parliament, and a very senior parliamentarian, a woman, she said, Professor Malmot, from your experience around the world, I'd like you to help us. We're very concerned about gender equity in Sweden. I used to have a lot of hair, but I pulled it all out. You know, you think about the only place I think that's done better on gender equity than Sweden is Norway, next door. I mean, what are we going to tell Sweden from around the world? So what's interesting about the Nordic countries is they don't feel they've done it well enough. I went to the Swedish government when we were doing the WHO Commission on Social Determinants of Health, and as I did in Quebec and Mexico and other places, I urged them to set up a national commission. And they wouldn't do it. But the city of Malmö set one up for Malmö. And they set up a commission for a socially sustainable Malmö. I blessed it, you know, when they started and when they finished, and we worked with them. And then the city of Gothenburg did it. And then the cities of Linköping and Norrköping did it. And then Östersund wrote to me. Östersund has worse weather than Montreal, so I wasn't all that keen. I feel very at home here, by the way, today, looking out the window this morning. I thought, you know, wet and grey. I felt very at home. Could have been in London. And in fact, now in Sweden, they have set up, finally, a national commission. So, at the end of the English review, at the end of the European review, and I'm very grateful she's sitting here with a copy of my book. The last words of my book, do something, do more, do it better, that came from Sweden. So the Swedes are doing a great deal, but they feel they need to do it better. And I think that is a partial answer to your question, that no matter how well the countries are doing, they still feel the need to do it better.
The young lady's second question has to do with, do you have examples of countries where politicians approached you directly to ask for advice?
Yeah, I do. I mean, well, to come back to Sweden, the Minister of Health, when, the government changed, Minister of Health, who in age is between, his age is between that of my first son and my second son, and he approached me and he invited me to come and have breakfast with him. I was going to Stockholm to give a lecture, and he approached me, and in fact that conversation led to the setting up of this Swedish National Commission. In Norway, there was a Minister of Foreign Affairs who came to a meeting that I was at and said, "I'm a Minister of Foreign Affairs. I am a health minister, because what I do in my day job impacts on health. What all ministers do impacts on health," he said. And then I got a phone call from an official in the Ministry of Health in Norway saying, "You know, you've been going around the world quoting our Minister of Foreign Affairs saying, I am a health minister. He now is our health minister. And he wants to meet you. So would you come to Oslo and meet him?" Which I did. So, and I've had a few of those.
Okay, thank you very much for this. Next question.
Hi, thank you for your talk. I'm a public health student at McGill University, about to graduate and hopefully enter in the research world on social determinants of health. So my question for you, among your many hats, you're also a physician, and the research question I'm aiming to answer is, what are the roles health workers can play addressing the social determinants of health in clinical practice? And part two of that question is, how do you answer to those who are skeptical about their role?
Well, when I agreed to have my name go forward to be president of the World Medical Association for a year, I made it, when they first asked me, I said, absolutely not. You know, I'm social determinants, my thing. Doctors, not my thing. And they said, but look, you're getting the doctors talking about social determinants of health. So I said that I had three aims as president under the social determinants of health rubric. I wanted the World Medical Association to issue a declaration on social determinants of health. In fact, we agreed it in Oslo and approved in Moscow last year. So we do have a Declaration of Oslo on social determinants of health. And to that end, when I said, when doctors ask the question you just asked, so what can doctors and other health professionals do, we will produce a report answering that question. And in fact, I'm going to present that report to the Council of the WMA in Buenos Aires this month. And our draft says five things: education and training, undergraduate and postgraduate, seeing the patient in a broader perspective, and I quote a former Canadian president of the Canadian Medical Association, Jeff Turnbull, who practiced medicine in the homeless, among the homeless. And he said, how can I treat their pneumonia and diabetes and liver disease and send them back to the street? Didn't make any sense. The first line of my book, I've already quoted the last line, the first line of my book is, what good does it do to treat people and send them back to the conditions that made them sick? So seeing the patient in the broader perspective. The third is the health service as employer. Very important, the conditions of work, not just for doctors and nurses, but for cleaners and lab technicians and the like. And the health service, I mean, in some areas, you go to Cleveland, the two big employers are the Cleveland Clinic and Case Western. Everything else is gone. I think they've got it's a sports stadium, but I couldn't figure out which sport it was. But anyway, somebody will tell me. But it's a big sports stadium. And then they've got all this medical stuff. That's it. Johns Hopkins is the biggest employer, I think, in the state of Maryland. Well, certainly in Baltimore. So the health service as employer. The fourth is working in partnership, which relates to your question, working with people who know things that we don't. about early child development, about social support for older people and work and the like. And the fifth, I can't get up there, is to be advocates, to be advocates for better health for our patients and for the communities that we serve. I nearly fell off.
You get the answer in a full report. This
yeah,
is
also
very
the
rich.
Skepticism, if health workers are skeptical about this.
Well, if I think there are two parts to the skepticism. One part is, where's the evidence we can do any good? Well, here you are. Here's the evidence. The second part is, I don't think that's my role as a doctor. Okay, don't do it. Don't do it. And do whatever you do. I'm not very good on you should do this or you should do that. Don't do, I tell governments what they should do all the time, but they don't listen, so that's all right. But I'm not very good. I would never say to the doctor, you should. You know, if you're a good surgeon, do good surgery. When people need surgery, they need excellent technicians. So do that. If you're not, that doesn't grab you. But what I'm finding is increasing numbers are recognizing how important that is. I mean, I spent, I can't figure out what day it is anymore, Thursday morning at St. Michael's Hospital in Toronto. I can't imagine of having had that conversation a few years before. We had a breakfast meeting, and here was St. Michael's, you know, a tertiary care institution, part of a great university, saying, how can we improve things for our local population? That's what we want to do. That's part of our mission, and that's part of our values. Wow, that's pretty good. That's worth getting up early in the morning for a lousy breakfast.
We have time for one last question.
Hi, Sarah Ma. I'm with McGill, graduate student at McGill University. It was really refreshing to hear you say that you view health researchers as both advocates, but also as health policy, in some ways being political decisions. In Canada, we're in a moment where we're trying to decide how we address economic insecurity. And there, in the 70s, we had a project that you probably know about that was the Mincome Project in yes. Manitoba. The data was analyzed by Evelyn Forger. And now in Ontario, we are considering some version of basic income. So I'm wondering, and I'm part of some of the organizations that are campaigning for this. We're also having a meeting with the North American Basic Income Guarantee group in Manitoba actually next month. I'm wondering what you view your role as a health researcher in, at, if you see merit in a basic income, what your role is in helping us to campaign for such a policy as a matter of good health policy.
Well, let me say a couple of things. Firstly, in all those, Louise, not there, in, there she is, in all those decades that Louise hinted at that I did research, it was pure research. It was not applied research, but it was mainly not applied research because there was no government that wanted to apply it. When the government changed, the pure research became potentially applied research. So I wasn't doing research that was directly policy related, but conceptually it could have been policy related. So that's the first thing, that I'm all for pure research, blue skies research, curiosity driven research, terrific. I don't frown on it at all. I also think that it's very good to be involved in evaluating policies. And I think having a good health component of a proposal on minimum income is really very important, because that would be, if it works, that would be part of the argument for implementing it. And as I understand about the Mincome, is that what it was called? The Mincome experiment in Canada, there were demonstrable health benefits. And so that's part of the argument. And that it comes back to what I was saying to the Canadian Medical Association earlier in the week, that rather than think about, well, we're left or right or liberal or conservative, and in Canada it seems to me it all gets a bit mixed up. Well, maybe it's just Quebec that it all gets mixed up. But instead of saying we're left or right or something else, we come at it from a health point of view. And that I think it's quite a reasonable question. Would a guaranteed minimum income improve the health and well-being of people? There are a whole lot of questions that are a bit outside our particular ken, which is about human dignity and administrative simplicity or complexity and all of those things that are just slightly marginal to what we do. Well, I'd say human dignity is pretty central, but the administrative complexity and things like that are slightly marginal. But the health part is key, so that my own view, I've been pushing strongly, is that being below the minimum income threshold is very bad for health. That was one of the recommendations of my English review, and that's what I was talking about this morning. So doing an experiment that says, well, let's see if we can't do it and make a difference seems to me quite important, with one caveat. With one caveat. The evidence on early child development, I find, a lot of it from Canada, very compelling, that we know really what harms early child development, and at least in theory, we know what to do to make a difference. In Britain, in the early 2000s, the government designed a new program called Sure Start, and to their credit, decided to evaluate it. So they set it up, it wasn't randomized, but they set it up so there are comparison communities. Well, all sorts of things happened. They rolled out and they messed it up and all sorts of things happened. So the evaluation was really quite equivocal. So what we ended up with was this colossal expensive experiment and nobody quite agreeing on what it showed. Because when you're doing real life stuff, it's very hard to get a properly controlled experiment. So I looked at it and I thought, look, I can see local areas that showed a real difference. The fact that the overall evaluation was ambiguous didn't dent my enthusiasm. Well, you could say I'm just prejudiced. And similarly, people who thought, well, we shouldn't spend money on stuff like that, say, well, look, didn't make any difference. Why waste public money? So the caveat is that when you're doing real life big experiments like that, it can often lead to equivocal results that are difficult to interpret.
Thank you very much. Malheureusement, il n'y a plus de temps. Monsieur Michael a un horaire chargé et on va devoir tout de suite le remercier. Alors je laisse Marie-France et nous lui dire merci.
Sir Michael, thank you for an excellent talk, as usual, but also for giving us the courage to continue our work in research and in intervention in reducing health inequalities. We now have evidence-based optimism. So.